And again, he is risen. He is risen indeed. Yes. Please, let's turn to John 20, starting with verse 1. I'm a little loud, am I? All right. I'm going to get loud. Okay. I have interesting things that go through my head, all right? This thing actually thinks once in a while. But it had to do with the 3 days that Jesus was in the grave, that Jesus was dead. You know, from Scripture we understand that Jesus gave up the Spirit at noon on Friday. You know, that is when everything turned black for 3 hours. The earth began to shake. The curtain in the temple was torn from top to bottom. That's when Jesus said, my God, why have you forsaken me? And then he said, it's finished. But he also said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And into thy hands I commit my spirit. That's when the tombs opened up and many holy people who were dead were raised to life. That was Friday. This is Sunday. He's risen! Yeah, 3 days. 3 days? Yes, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. But the thought went through my head that these were not just 24-hour days. Jesus wasn't in a tomb 24 times 3. That equals 72 hours. He rose from the dead early Sunday morning. He is risen! You know, I get so excited, you know, and because of the exponential awesomeness of Jesus rising from the dead, it's hard to go through and say, okay, just 3 days, why make a big deal of that? You know, Jesus is risen, you know. But here's my thinking and where it's carrying me. So Jesus dies at 12 o'clock p.m. on Friday. That's when the skies went black. Jesus raised from the dead at sunrise on Sunday. Now John says, while it was still dark. Anybody was up this morning while it was still dark? You know, wasn't it glorious? But let's say 6 a.m. because Jesus died the sixth hour from the dawn, okay? And that's less than 48 hours. It's 42 hours to be specific. Let's read John 20, starting with verse 1. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." So Peter, the other disciple, started for the tomb, and both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter. Man, John must have been fast. Anyways, and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb, and he saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. He's risen. Yes. You know, John saw and believed. Wiersbe notes that when John wrote this account, he used 3 different Greek words for seeing. In John 20, verse 5, the word simply means to glance in, to look in. In John 20, verse 6, the word means to look carefully, to observe. And the word saw in John 20, verse 8, means to perceive with intelligent comprehension. The resurrection faith was now dawning. Now, we'll continue where we left off here, but please, let's turn with me to Matthew 12:38. So keep a bookmark in John 20, if you will. You know, I hope that this morning we're all at the third level. comprehending and intelligently comprehending that Jesus Christ is risen. Still, there's that 72 hour, three full days and nights question that lingers in my mind. You know, I looked for explanations or comments in quite a few commentaries during the resurrection events and all of them. And they just seem to say, whoa, Jesus is risen, you know. And they don't discuss, you know, well, it wasn't quite 3 days. They just say, he's risen. Here's the proof. He rose from the dead. The soldiers were guarding it. The seal was broken. Everything. It was so awesome. Jesus is risen. It was 3 days. Jesus rose from the dead. And the commentaries I read dealing directly with the resurrection event are mute as to this idea of why 3 days, 72 hours. But something inside of me wanted to get to the bottom of this. So I did find some commentaries that addressed this three-day issue back when Jesus made a reply to the Pharisees in Matthew 20, verse 38. And so we'll read this, and this is Jesus predicting his time and his stay in the tomb and in the grave. Verse 38 says, then some of the Pharisees and teachers of the law said to him, teacher, we want to see a miraculous sign from you. He answered, a wicked and adulterous generation asks for a miraculous sign, but none will be given it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of a huge fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Okay, is that pretty clear? 3 days, 3 nights in the heart of the earth, just like Jonah was in the fish. Okay, so I'm going to list some comments from the commentaries. The commentary on Old Testament and New Testament by Robert Jamieson, A.R. Fawcett, and David Brown says that the period during which he was to lie in the grave, he is here expressed in round numbers. According to the Jewish way of speaking, which was to regard any part of a day, however small, including within a period days, as a full day. Okay, John Wesley's explanatory notes on the whole Bible says, it was customary with the Eastern nations to reckon any part of a natural day of 24 hours for a whole day. Robertson Word Pictures says that 3 days and 3 nights may simply mean 3 days in popular speech. Jesus rose on the third day, not on the fourth day. It is just a fuller form of after 3 days. And then finally, the pulpit commentary says that the words are perhaps a mere adaptation of the phrase in Jonah and are here used only to roughly mark the time of our Lord's stay in the grave. Observe, however, that the addition of nights tends to emphasize the reality of our Lord's stay there. It was a matter of days and nights. He spent both kinds of earthly time in the heart of the earth. Please, let's turn back to John 20, verse 9. And there's other commentaries, Adam Clark's commentary and then Matthew Henry's commentary and the whole Bible. They all said similar things. And the purpose of the resurrection was so that we could celebrate and so that we could experience the resurrection. And we don't need to get nitpicky, right? The numbers shouldn't matter. So are we just on some wild goose chase? Should we limit our interpretation of the Bible to what the scholars say? Is this just a dead subject? You know, where most Bible commentaries brush over this, while they brush over this, the skeptics don't. I don't know if you saw that slide. That's a skeptic slide saying, hey, this does not compute. 2 days max? That's what they're saying. And then there's another one that says Friday to Sunday. A day and a half equals bad math. So it expresses that the Bible has flaws. And for some reason, this explanation of rounding down the 72-hour period of 3 days and 3 nights to a conservative estimate of 42 hours of death doesn't quite settle my question. Am I being kind of petty here? Am I? Well, there's just a small detail. When we're talking about the resurrection of Jesus, he's risen. if the disciples wanted to, they could have fixed the numbers to reconcile the hours for a better story. But this wasn't a story. This was an event. This happened. This was history. The disciples reported the facts. They didn't corroborate with each other the numbers, days, events, and quotes. They were eyewitnesses of and wrote down what they saw, experienced, and heard. They not only wrote them down, they gave their lives for these events and for these truths. You know, one idea I like to consider on this third day topic is that Jesus' resurrection wasn't complete that morning. And you say, what? Well, let's look at John 20, starting with verse 9. They still did not understand. Remember the last part we read in verse 8, John saw and he believed. But then it says in quotes here, they still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They've taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not recognize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was a gardener, she said, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him, and I'll get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus says, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with this news. "I've seen the Lord," she said to them. And she told them that she had, and she told them that he had said these things to her. Let's stop there for just a little bit. You know, if Jesus' resurrection wasn't complete that morning, that would account for more than 48 hours. Okay, that would get us into the third day, okay? Especially if it wasn't until Jesus visited the disciples that evening. Jesus says, "Don't hold on to me. I have not returned yet to my Father." Okay? In verse 19, it says, "On the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.'" Okay? Boo! The disciples, you know, they were all scared, huddled together in their room. They had all the doors locked. And then Jesus, they all of a sudden, he goes, "Peace be with you, guys!" You know, woo! You know, ah! I love the character of Jesus. Peace, yeah, right. Verse 20, after he had said this, he showed them his hands and side, and the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Please, let's turn to Genesis 2:17, and we'll also take a look at Genesis 5 in a little bit, too. The disciples were overjoyed. Why? Why were the disciples overjoyed? He was risen indeed. Yeah. Jesus' resurrection may not have been complete until he returned to his Father. You know, this is awesome. Okay? This explanation moves the death of Jesus well into the third day. There's still something stirring in me that I feel explanations fall just short of the full 3 days. What is a full day of work? 8 hours? 10 hours? 12 hours? You know, a full day of work for the farmer, what's that? 20 hours. An ambulance driver or a fire truck, what's a full day? 24 hours. You know, camp's coming up, and there will be 7 times 24 hours that I'm going to be at camp. I'm looking forward to it. I really am. Actually, it's just 6 days, but who's doing the math, right? We don't need to do the math. I leave Sunday afternoon. I get back Saturday afternoon or evening. But anyways, we read from Matthew 12:40. It says, "For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of a fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth." You know, we may have reconciled a little time after the resurrection when Jesus hadn't been yet with the Father. And he wasn't quite touchable and complete. And now he was with the disciples and he could be touched and he could be handled and he could even eat. I think he ate some fish, broiled fish that night. But what about before he breathed his last? Could Jesus have experienced death before he said, "Into thy hands I commit my spirit"? Could Jesus have not been fully alive at noon on Good Friday? You know, I'm not trying to make a doctrine here, but an observation. When did Adam die? Genesis 5:5 says, "Altogether Adam lived 930 years, and then he died." It also says in Genesis 2:17, "But you must not eat of the tree from of knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat of it, you will surely die." So the word "when" in the NIV literally means "in the day you eat of that tree." In the day you eat of that tree. Well, what's with the Bible in days, right? Now, I'm just going to preach for just a little while, guys, okay? Just a few seconds in Adam's timeline of his day of 930 years, all right? So bear with me. You can hang in there. But what happened to Adam the day he ate of the tree? The day he ate of the tree. He died. How? What's death? Death is separation. Separation from God. He died spiritually. Could Jesus have died spiritually before he died physically? Could there have been a time when Jesus began to carry the weight of the sins of the world and the Father turned his face away before he hung on that cross and bore our sins? You know, maybe, you know, while he was praying in the garden and he sweat great drops of blood. Maybe it was when he was distributing the Passover that Last Supper with his disciples, and he says, "This is my body broken for you. This is my blood was shed for you." Please let's turn to Colossians 3:1. Now, this is just an observation that goes with the fact that we were dead. You know, like Adam, after he ate from the tree, experienced a spiritual death, we experience spiritual death even as we live. I've been there. And I experience a little taste of that spiritual death once in a while. And I look at myself, almost an outer body experience, like, "What are you doing, you crazy idiot? You're supposed to be dead to that stuff." When we trust in Christ, we go through a 3-day process like Jonah and Jesus. Just like the 3 stages of John, when he glanced in the tomb and looked carefully in the tomb and he saw the stuff laying there. And then he believed, he understood. And he perceived with intelligence with what he saw in the tomb. You know, when I say we go through a 3-day process, the time frame is figurative, okay? We'll look at the 3-day process of the resurrection in our lives. And it should pop up there slowly. There we go. Day 1, we become aware of our sin. and death and repent. You know, like Jesus in the garden, we cry out to God, not my will, but thine be done. Day two, we accept Jesus or entrust our life to him. Jesus' blood cleanses us from our sin. And then day three, we are raised to new life by the power of the Holy Spirit. Just like Jesus rose from the grave, we are raised with him to new life. Our dead man is raised to new life. Okay, there we are. Let's read Colossians 3, starting with verse 1. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated in the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. You know, we're still in a time of flux here, guys. When I trusted in Jesus Christ as my Savior and I repented of my sins and Jesus washed away my sins and then the Spirit of God raised me to new life in Christ, I didn't immediately get transported up to the Father and said, here I am, I'm ready, I'm whole, I'm resurrected. You know what I'm saying? We're in a state of flux. We're not there yet. I'm still dealing with the dead old man. I'm still trying to put him to death. And holding on and expressing to myself the truth that old man doesn't live no more, but Jesus lives in me. We're still in a time of flux where we have been given new life, yet we've not gone to the Father yet. Are you following me? Is this something that we can at least understand? We need to leave the tomb and those grave clothes behind and set our mind on things where? Things above. We're done with that old man. You know, that's not our home anymore. That old man, that old lifestyle, that isn't where we live, that isn't where we dwell. And a lot of times we're still playing with our old grave clothes, you know, and they're starting to kind of stink by now. You know, does sin get a little bit worse and more smelly as you live the Christian life? It does, doesn't it? I mean, when before we were dead, I mean, it probably smelled like perfume. Oh, man, sin is awesome. But when we trust in Christ, all of a sudden we see sin for what it is. It's a decaying mess, and it's going to kill us, and it's going to destroy our family and our friends and everything around us. And then we start seeing sin for what it is. I mean, we get awakened. Our nasal passages get cleansed, and pretty soon sin is utterly sinful. We don't want nothing to do with it. And guess what? We need to go put that stuff away. We need to get rid of it. So we set our minds on things in heaven, not on things of the earth. And verse 5 of Colossians 3, it says, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature, sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must rid yourself of all such things as these. Anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge and the image of its creator. You know, as believers, we're still in a state of flux, okay? We're somewhere between the empty tombs and standing before God. It's all totally justified, just as if we had never sinned, totally with the righteous robe of Jesus Christ. We're right there in the middle there. But praise God, we can say we serve a risen Christ. Christ was raised. God will complete the process of renewal in the knowledge of the image of who? Jesus, the Creator. This is the third day. as believers in Christ, we're in the third day. I mean, it's so cool. We're just right there. We aren't yet physically present with the Father, but we have exited the tomb and are shedding those grave clothes to be renewed in the image of our Creator. Now, isn't this exciting? I love it. He is risen. May I have some men come forward to distribute the communion this morning? Jesus, 3 days. 3 days before he rose from the dead and gave and presented himself before the Father and presented himself resurrected to his disciples and to the witnesses. 3 days before, he took bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take, eat." You take, eat all of it. Remember and believe. His blood is sufficient. And 3 days before he rose from the grave, he also took the cup, saying that this is his blood. We remember his death in this way till he comes again. You know, drink all of this, understanding that his blood cleanses us from all unrighteousness. The bread, the cup, two symbols of what Jesus did for us. There's a third symbol, and that symbol is you. You are the third day of Jesus' life. "Why do you search for the living among the dead?" the angel said. "He's not here. He is risen." You are being renewed in the knowledge and in the image of our great Creator, Lord, and King, Jesus, who did not stay in the grave, but he rose from the grave so that we would all have that hope. But even now, we can experience that new life inside of us as we wait for his coming. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for your word. Lord, we thank you so much for all you've done. You created us. And Lord, even though we rejected you, even though we rebelled against you, even though that we just wanted to live for ourselves, you saw our plight and you saw where it was headed. And you opened up that through the law that where we were going. But that you didn't just leave us to stagnate in our own death. But you loved the world, that you gave your only begotten Son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Lord, what kind of love is this? Lord, as we kind of grapple with the meaning of your death and your burial and your resurrection, Lord, help us to understand that you would do it all. Not only will you allow us to die to ourselves and to get washed clean, but you empower us to live, and you will seal it until the day of redemption. Lord, in this we hope, and in this we can profess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Lord, we thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen.